Hey listeners, welcome back to another out-of-the-world new story with Revolving Time, where we bring you real-life stories that explore the complexities of the human experience. We hope that our stories have provided you with insights, inspiration, and a renewed appreciation for the power of human resilience. Okay, let's go to the story and see what happened there. Wife packed her stuff and moved in with her sister, leaving me with kids. Finally, I found a way to handle her. Published by Slurpuff. I'm not ducking dead yet, the voice in my head screamed as my wife said no to love for the 1000th time. Love, 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 is that all you think about? Carol snapped at me. If I got it once in a while, I wouldn't be thinking about it all the time, I replied. If I gave you love as much as you wanted it, we'd be doing it 24/7 inches, she shot back. And your point? For Christ's sake, you're 58 years old, and you've got the love drive of a teenager. You're supposed to be slowing down. I can't do it every day. I need time to juice back up, Carol shouted at me. So the conversation went for the umpteenth time. We had tried to work out compromises, but they never worked. I wanted to do it 4 times a week, but would settle for 3. Carol wanted once every other week, but would settle for once per week. Duck, I couldn't win. We finally settled on 2x a week, once during the week and once on the weekend. This lasted for a week or two, and then we were back to 1x a week. I was stymied. How could you not want to do something that gives you so much pleasure? To me, love with your wife was the best. I would do it every chance I could if she was willing. But that's the problem, she wasn't. Update. Believe it or not, Carol had the higher love drive when we first got married. I was working crazy hours at Home Depot as a new department manager and was always tired. She, on the other hand, was always lusting at me, and I guess I turned her down too many times. After a while, she just stopped asking. I guess too many rejections has a way of cooling you off. Just to give you a little background on myself. My name is Jim Moore, and I'm going to be turning 59 this month. Physically, I'm in better shape than I was at 25. I bike, run, skate, and go to the gym at least 4 days a week. I come from a large Catholic family, 5 brothers and 4 sisters, so you know there was love going on in our house. I married at 21. Anne and I met just before I went into the Marines in 1969. After boot camp, we communicated through letters, phone calls, and I saw her only on my leaves. Why she went out and stuck with me, I'll never know. She was one of the most popular girls around, and even though she was being hit on all the time, she was true to me while I was away. My year in Vietnam changed me a lot. I was no longer the happy-go-lucky guy who didn't have a care in the world. I became a lot more serious. War has a way of doing that to you. I proposed one drunken night on the phone, and she accepted. She did call the next night to confirm that I'd really meant to ask her. When I got out, we got married. And after 2 kids, the first being a mistake, we had a pretty decent life. Things were hot and heavy for the first 5 years, but somehow life got in the way and work, and the kids became our main focus. I never saw it coming. Everyone knew she was ducking around but me. They say love makes you deaf, dumb, blind, and stupid, and I can now attest to that. Perry was one of our best friends, I guess her more so than me. Anne was on her weekend getaway when I found out. I tried to reach her at the motel because of a family emergency, but she hadn't even checked in. I frantically called Gary, whose wife Penny was supposed to be with Anne this weekend, thinking that they'd changed motels and she had called him. Consider my shock when his wife answered the phone. Between Gary and I, we found out what the duck was going on and with whom. God, did I feel stupid. Everyone was laughing behind my back, and no one had the decency to ducking tell me, with friends like that, who needs enemies. She was shacked up at his apartment, and Penny was covering her as asterisk for her. The earth moved when my loving wife came home Sunday night. It got real ugly with her packing up her stuff and moving in with her sister, leaving me with the kids. To make a long story short, she filed, got custody of the kids, and I got ducked big time. I ended up paying 30% of my salary in child support and lost the ducking house. Was I bitter? Hell yes. Did I want revenge? Yes, but it took me 12 years to get it. The one thing I did learn was to keep your eyes wide open, especially when your gut tells you there's something wrong. Update 1. 2 years later, I thought I found the girl of my dreams, Diana. Good-looking with a great body, smart, had a professional job, and most of all, she loved love. We spent more than one weekend during the cold winter months in bed the entire weekend away. I didn't have a lot of extra money, due to getting ripped by child support, but that made no difference to her. She loved me. Within 9 months, we were close to moving in together. It was after dinner one night Diane got all serious and said she wanted to talk to me about something. SHT, here it comes. The brush off. I thought to myself as we sat down on her couch. There's something I've been meaning to talk to you about for a while, but I just don't know how to tell you. So here it goes. I can't have kids, she told me. Okay, what's the problem? I asked. You mean you don't care? She replied. My last boyfriend couldn't hit the door fast enough, she told me. Look, Diana, I already have two boys that are more than a handful. Even though it might have been nice to have a child with you, it isn't a deal breaker for me anyway, I told her. You'd think I just told her that she'd won the lottery, the way Diana was all over me after that. We spent that night and the next day in bed. I moved in with her, and 6 months later, we got married in a small family ceremony. I should have known, with my past bad luck, that something was coming, but it came fast and hard. Diane worked for GM, and it seems that they were closing their Minneapolis office. Because of her years of service, she was given her choice of transfer locations, including Memphis 10 or Jacksonville, Florida. How often do you get a chance to transfer from the frozen north of Minnesota to sunny Florida? Guess which location we picked. The company bought our house and even shipped us to Florida so we could find a house before transferring. God, I loved this company. We found a beautiful house 5 miles from the beach, and life was finally starting to go our way. We moved, and then it all started to unravel. The pay scale in Florida suck **ed, and the jobs were few and far between. There was very little manufacturing, and what there were paid only 50% of what I was making up north. I finally took a supervisory job in a paper converting plant on second shift. The work was hard, and the pay didn't even cover all my expenses when you took my child support into consideration. Life became pretty rough. I did odd jobs to supplement our income, but that meant I was away from home, and Dee hated that. Our life together became tense, and our love life started drying up. GM was always sending her to some type of training or team building seminars. They were always during the week and lasted anywhere from 2 to 5 days. Every time she came back from one of these outings, we seemed to grow further apart. I tried to turn it around, but nothing seemed to work. 2 days after her last trip, Dee announced that she wanted a divorce. We're no longer close, and I feel it time to get on with my life, she told me. There isn't anyone else, Jim. It's just that I don't love you anymore. That was a major hit to my ego and masculinity. Having gone through it once before, I basically said duck it, and she could have her divorce if she was that ducking unhappy. Money was very tight, so she moved into the spare bedroom. Dee went to work at 8 o'clock every morning, but most days I didn't start until almost 11 o'clock. I told a few of my buds at work, and to a one they thought she was cheating on me. When I waited for Dee to go to work, and then searched her bedroom. It didn't take me more than 10 minutes to find letters and even a tape of her new man. He also worked for GM, but in another division. They were getting together every time she went on one of her working seminars. The ducking **TCH, I screamed as I put everything back where I'd found it, excluding the videotape. I did, however, make 2 copies, sending one to her parents and the one I kept in a secure place. I took half of our meager savings and found a small apartment across from where I worked. It was in a very bad neighborhood, but the rent was cheap. 2 days later, SHT hit the fan. Her parents called the house, and I told them that their loving daughter was cheating on me and that we were going to get a divorce. They wanted to talk to her, but I said she was out and that she didn't know yet that I knew about her and her new duck buddy, and yes, I had sent them the tape. They said they'd call back tomorrow around supper time. I thanked them for being such supportive in-laws, and that I'd miss them, boy, I laid it on thick. GM was a whole different matter. I made 2 more copies and sent 1 each to their bosses with a note saying that because of their affair, my wife and I were getting a divorce. That I was going to pursue my legal rights, because basically the 2 of them were ducking around at a company-sponsored seminar. It didn't take more than 24 hours for someone to contact me. They didn't give a SHT about my marriage, my wife, or her duck buddy. But when I mentioned something about going public and talking to a reporter, I got their attention. My wants were simple, I told them. Pay for my upcoming divorce, 6 months of rent, demote the 2 of them, and put a written reprimand in their personal file. I knew that once a black mark was in their files, they'd never be promoted again, a gift that keeps giving. Diane came home and was spitting fire. I told her to sit down so we could talk, but it was way beyond that. Look, B*TCH, if you hadn't ducked around on me, I would have walked away, and you never would have heard a peep out of me, I explained. But I found out you've been lying to me for at least 6 months, and probably ducking him for at least as long. Dee tried to say it was only about the 2 of us. But I'd already heard enough of her bull SHD. Duck yourself, Dee. I'm almost moved out, and by the way, your mom and dad will be calling tonight to find out why a daughter of theirs decided to cheat on her husband. Have a good life, I said as I walked out for the final time. I let her get an attorney and divorce me. She tried sticking me with a lot of bills and SHT, so I just threatened to do a Chapter 7 and told them all to duck off. About 4 months later, she sold the house and moved away, where I couldn't tell you. And frankly, I didn't give a SHT. Update 2. One night a year later, I burned our wedding pictures one by one, ending that chapter in my life. So here I sit wondering what the hell to do. As you read in the first part of my story, Carol's love drive has dwindled to almost nothing, and here I sit wondering what to do. Outside of love, Carol is perfect. She's good-looking, a great cook, and we have basically the same likes and dislikes. We joked around when we got married that before either one of us ever thought of getting a divorce, we'd commit sui**, because the stigma of 3 divorces would be way too much humiliation for either one of us to live with. So, with that in mind, I decided to take 2 lovers. You may ask why 2, and that's a valid question. If I took 1, I might get too hung up with her and do something stupid like leave my wife. With 2, however, I would be having love with 3 women, satisfying my urges and splitting my time equally among them. I never considered it cheating, because I wasn't taking anything from Carol that she wanted or needed. So my search began. My company was donating old computers to needy individuals attending the community college. I was in charge of handing them out, so when I met Dawn, I took notice. She was a single mother, who was going to school at night to get her a degree. I got her a CPU monitor and told her I'd work on securing her a printer. To say she was overjoyed was an understatement. 2 weeks later, I gave her an old HP printer and 2 reams of paper. You may think that I'm some type of ducking predator. No way. It's just that Dawn was damn good looking, and I couldn't imagine how she could be single. I'd forgotten about her until 3 weeks later, when Dawn asked if I had the Microsoft Office software package. I don't know if it's legal for me to pass it around, but if you don't tell anyone where you got it, I guess it'll be all right, I told her. We kicked around how we were going to handle this when she ended the discussion. Look, I don't normally give out my address, but you seem to be safe, being married and all. So if me meet me at my house after 6 o'clock, we can dot it on my machine, she told me. Hell, I'll even throw in dinner, she said with a smile. I told Carol I'd be late, and not to wait dinner on me. I rang Dawn's bell at 5 to 6, and a little girl answered. Is your mommy home? I asked. She nodded and opened the door for me. Standing in the doorway, I waited for Dawn. I think you should tell your daughter not to let anyone in the house, I told her when she came in from the kitchen. You don't know how many crazies there are out there. Better to be safe than sorry. She thanked me, told me she'd talk to her girl, and showed me into the den where the computer was set up. Loading the disks, it said it would take 2 hours to fully load. As I said, it was an old computer. "Why it's loading, why don't we have a bite to eat?" she asked. "Works for me. Where can I wash up?" I asked. "Use the bathroom down the hall to the right," she instructed. The house was in total disrepair. The sinks leaked, the handles on all the doors were loose, and 100 other things that a husband normally fixes. She explained that she kicked her ex-husband out when she caught him fooling around with a woman at his work. She forgave him once, but the second time, she caught them in their marital bed, and she kicked his as asterisk out. No loss. He hadn't touched me in a year anyway. I guess he was getting all he could handle from his group of whores, she told me. God, how could you stand not having love for a year? I'd have gone ballistic, I laughed. I have my little girl, work and night school, so I really don't have the time to think about it, she told me. Besides, he was a lousy lay anyway, she said in a matter-of-fact voice. Let's check on that software and see how it's coming, she told me. Damn, it's still got another hour to go, I exclaimed. Look, you have any tools around here? I asked. As long as we're waiting, let me do a few things that need to be done, I told her, and that's what I did for the next hour and a half. Dawn got her daughter ready for bed, and I went room to room repairing whatever I could. By 8:30, the baby was in bed, and the software had just finished loading. Thanks for all your help, Dawn said, walking into the den. Now I don't have to worry about getting locked into the bathroom and having the doorknob come off in my hand again, she said with a laugh. You really are a jack of all trades, she told me. How are you with electrical? She inquired. I have a dryer out in the garage that I can't use because I don't have the right plug set up. An electrician told me that he'd do it for $150 plus parts. But I don't have a $150, she told him. Show me what you've got, and I'll see what I can do. She took me to her garage and showed me her dryer and electrical box. All I need is a standard dryer plug, a receptacle and a box, and you'll be up and running. I'll get the parts and put it in Thursday night if you're home. It shouldn't take no more than an hour, I told her. That would be great, she told me. No more going to the laundromat, she said with a smile. Well, I've got to be getting home, I told her. Why don't I plan on stopping right after work on Thursday, and I'll even bring the pizza. I can't argue with that, she replied. She walked me to the door, stopped for a moment, and kissed me. Thank you for all your help. I appreciated it more than you can imagine, she said, giving me another. This time with tongue. I started getting a tent in my pants. I'd better go, or I'm going to end up giving you something special also, I said with a smile as I walked to his car. I told Carol that night I'd be helping a few people in the Parents Without Partners group. On the nights she had things planned. They just need a few things fixed in their homes, and they don't have the money to get them done. I told her. Well, if there's one thing you know how to do, is how to fix things, she replied. I wanted to jump her bones that night, but she gave me the better luck next time look, so I took a cold shower and went to bed, damn it. I was at Dawn's house shortly after 5:30. It should be an easy job, unless I ran into something weird. I shut off the power, installed the box and receptacle, attached the plug and presto a working dryer. I moved the dryer next to the washing machine so Dawn could put the wet clothes from one to the other and went looking for her. She was in the kitchen preparing something when I came up behind her. Done. What's next on the agenda? I asked. A startled Dawn jumped back, almost falling to the floor. I caught her before we both went onto the kitchen table. I never heard you come in, an embarrassed Dawn told me as she straightened her dress. You scared the SHT out of me. I'm not used to hearing a man's voice in the house, she said with a chuckle. Well, your dryer works. So I thought I'd look at the bathroom sinks, unless you have more pressing issues, I told her. There's so much that needs fixing. Knock yourself out, she told me. I replaced the washers, caulked the sinks, and cleaned out the traps dam. There was a lot of hair in them. That's the way they're supposed to work, I said with a swelled head. When you're good, you're good. By that time, Dawn had the pizza on the table and was calling for me. "Where's your little girl?" I asked. "Amy's at the neighbor's," she replied. "She's on a sleepover," Dawn answered. "We're alone tonight." As we started to eat, Dawn finally asked me, "What's your story, Jim? And don't give the bull SHD story about you being some kind of home-fixing saint. I felt you kiss me back before you left last time," she said, getting us another glass of wine. I relented and spilled my guts about my past, Carol, and my unsatisfied love life. "It's not like I don't love her. Because I do. But she's lost all her love drive. What am I supposed to do now?" I asked. "This," Dawn said, grabbing me by the hand and leading me into her bedroom. ... I took a quick shower. We made a standing date for every Thursday, unless something came up. Update 3. This went on for 2 months when Dawn added something else to the game. "Tammy's a single mother and has a house down the street that needs a man's touch, if you know what I mean. I've taken the liberty of telling her about my friend with benefits, and she's interested. You'd like her, blonde hair, blue eyes, and a tight body for a 45-year-old broad," Dawn said with a laugh. "If you'd like, we'll sneak over and talk to her, but only after you've taken care of my needs," she said with a wicked smile. We started on the kitchen counter that night. "We need a shower before we go over to Tammy's. We wouldn't want her to get the wrong idea now, would we?" she said, leading the way. Tammy has a small 3-bedroom house. It was clean, but had the same issues as Dawn's, little things that needed to be done. I told her I would be more than happy to help her. "I'll be so grateful if you would," she told me. Both of them laughed and said I was going to need vitamins in order to keep up with the two of them, and I probably would. Things got strained when Dawn added another woman to our group. Joyce's husband left her, but tore apart the house before he leaving. It took me 3 nights to just straighten the doors and put on new locks. What an asterisk hole. I was now getting more love than I'd ever had in my entire life and loved it. Literally, I could get laid every night if I wanted to, but ended up seeing Joyce on Tuesdays, Tammy on Wednesdays, and Dawn on Thursdays. This went on for 6 months, and that's when it fell apart. Carol had come up to me Friday after dinner and given me a hug. "I want to thank you for not bugging me for love the last couple of months. It makes it all that much more special when we make love now," she told me. "So tonight I'm going to give you something special," she said with a grin, grabbing my hand. We fell asleep in each other's arms and life was still good. After breakfast, we went to Lowe's so I could pick up a few things while Carol strolled through the garden shop. "Jim Moore," a voice from behind called my name. "Yes, I'm Jim," I replied, turning around. "My name is Beth Thomas. I got your name from Dawn and Tammy," she told me. "I don't know if you have the time, but I've got a few things I need done around my house, and being single, I don't have a clue where to start. I've been alone about a year since my husband left, so I'm really interested in your benefit package as well," she said with a smile. "This is my address and phone number," she said, giving me a kiss on the cheek. "Call me anytime. I'm always available," she said. If I'd been single, alone, or anything else, I would have been safe. But about 15 feet behind Beth stood my wife. I was ducked. "Hi, honey, this is Beth. She also needs a few things repaired at her place also," I said, trying to make light of the situation. "I also need his help with other issues, if you know what I mean," she said with a wink, probably thinking Carol was one of my other friends. "Jim's my husband, and if there's any issues he's going to work on, he's going to work on them at home, not with some slot," she told Beth in an angry tone. "Jim, we're leaving," Carol said, turning her back on both of us and headed towards the exit. "You're married?" was her first reply. "I had no idea, or I never would have said a word," she told me. "I think you're in big trouble," she said, watching Carol walk out the door. "Well, if she kicks you out, I have a spare bedroom you can crash in," she said as I ran towards the door. Final update. The ride home was quiet, too quiet. When I pulled into the garage, Carol bolted out of the car and into the house. I sat there for a minute pondering my next move when Carol yelled, Get yours asterisk in here now. Well, at least it's out in the open. Carol told me what a cheating bastard I was, and how she should just kick Maya's asterisk to the ducking curb. How she could never go into Lowe's because I was ducking all the women shopping there and on and on and on. Carol, why don't you shut the duck up? I finally told her. This was the first time in our marriage I'd spoken to her in that manner. Jim, how dare you talk to me in that tone? She replied. I stood up and started walking away when she yelled. Where the hell do you think you're going? We're not near done talking yet, she bellowed. Yes, we are, I replied. I'm going over to Dawn's house to fix a window or two, and then I'm going to duck her. So if you don't mind, I've got to gather up my tools, I told her. Carol just stood there with her mouth wide open, not having a clue what to say. You can't do that, Jim, you're married, she finally said. And so I responded. I told you, hell, I begged you to make love to me, Carol. I pleaded even for a mercy duck now and then, and you refused me flat, I told her. Do you know why I haven't been chasing you for the last 7 months? I've been getting all the love I can handle from three different women. I take care of their household repairs, and they take care of my needs, needs I'm not getting taken care of by my wife at home. So if you want me to leave, just say the word, because I've got more than one place I can move into. Just let me know, I told her as I went into the garage. I'd gotten my tools together, loaded them into my truck, and was about to leave when Carol came into the garage. We need to talk. But not out here, she told me. Okay, Carol, what do you want? I asked. Wear a rubber. I don't want you bringing home any diseases and giving me one, she told me. No, and we're not going to talk about it ever again, she told me. As far as I'm concerned, you're just helping out a few single mothers to keep a good roof over their head. That's all. How they pay you is up to them. But so help me Jim Moore. You get one of them knocked up or bring home a gift that I have to go to the doctor to get rid of. I'm not only going to kick your asterisk to the curb. I'm going to cut your dot off too, she yelled. So now you have a choice. You can take me upstairs and duck the SHT out of me or go over to Dawn's and fix her damn windows. What'll it be? Carol and I ducked for the next 2 hours, and I made damn sure she got off at least 4 times. After taking a break, Carol finally spoke up. I still can't do this every ducking day, she told me. And I'm in awe that you can satisfy 3. Make that 4 women week in and week out, she told me. Like I told you, satisfy your urges where you like. But you eat at ducking home, do you understand? Yes, dear, now enough talk. There's a few things I've learned over the last few months I've been dying to try, I told her. And we did for the rest of the day and night. Sunday morning, I was at Dawn's fixing 2 stuck windows, and Tuesday, I was at Joyce's taking care of something in her bedroom. Life was good. Over the years, I've gone through at least 12 different women and 10 different houses. The only constant during this time has been Dawn. It's come to a point where I think she's breaking things just to keep me around. Maybe I should tell her I'm willing to just take care of her needs without fixing anything. Maybe we'll have that conversation next week. But right now, Candy's got that look in her eyes that tells me it's time to take care of her special needs. A man's work is never done, I guess. The end. Thanks for watching. Remember, Revolving Time exists because of your support. Subscribe now, and let's uncover the hidden secrets and truths together.